You hear people talking about the civil rights era, and it's starting to sound like a three-day carnival. Rosa Parks didn't give up her seat on day one, and Dr. King led a march on Washington on day two, and on day three, we changed all the laws and racism was over. And that's not what happened. We had a generation of people, my parents, were humiliated every day of their lives. Those signs that said white and colored, they weren't directions, they were assaults. They created injuries, and we haven't treated those injuries.
Bryan Stevenson is used to making people feel uncomfortable about race and this country's history.
I have argued that slavery didn't end in 1865, it just evolved. And for the next century, we were dealing with that legacy. And that's why we lived through all of that violence and terror through lynchings. That's why we had laws that codified segregation. And that's why our criminal justice system was so menacing to people of color. We are haunted in America by our history of racial inequality.
The new HBO documentary, True Justice, Bryan Stevenson's Fight for Equality, details his life's journey and the creation of the Equal Justice Initiative.
My clients have been broken by trauma, broken by bias and discrimination.
The documentary focuses on his fight against the death penalty, his appearances before the Supreme Court on behalf of death row inmates.
The prosecution ran out that day and told the media that the state of Alabama got the worst killer that ever walked the streets in Birmingham off the streets that day. Only wasn't true.
A lot of this documentary revolves around the story of Anthony Ray Hinton, a death row inmate that you represented. Why does his case move you?
He was wrongly accused. He was charged with two murders that took place in the Birmingham area. And the powerful thing was that he had dramatic evidence of his innocence. He had a lock-solid alibi. He had no prior history of engaging in violent crime. They convicted him based on this claim that a gun found in his mother's house was the gun that could be matched to the bullets recovered from these murders. Now, that was not a reliable match, but because he was poor, he couldn't get his own expert to explain how that was incredible.
Hinton was exonerated in 2015 after 30 years on Alabama's death row.
When we won Mr. Hinton's release, he was the 152nd death row prisoner to be proved innocent after being sentenced to death. That's a shocking rate of error. And so his case, for me, is an indictment of everything that's problematic. It reflects the way in which we presume guilt when defendants of color are accused of something. It represents the way in which we don't provide people with the resources that they need. And it also represents a culture of policing and prosecuting and judging that doesn't seem as invested in getting it right in justice as I think our system should be.
Stevenson has quietly emerged as a powerful voice in the racial and criminal justice movements by confronting long-held historical narratives. He helped found the National Memorial for Peace and Justice, documenting the history of lynchings in this country. I met him there last fall.
You cannot understand the death penalty, and particularly its uniquely Southern focus, without understanding lynching and the legacy. All of these people were lynched because they were presumed dangerous and guilty.
With criminal justice reform now more widely embraced, Stevenson sees hope.
Do you feel like you're moving the needle?
I think so. I always felt like we were screaming, and it just didn't seem like it was resonating. I think that's changing.
But Stevenson insists real change will come when America owns its shame.
I think we have to own up to this history. We have to talk honestly about the brutality of enslavement.
Hey, NBC News fans, thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on that button down here and click on any of the videos over here to watch the latest interviews, show highlights, and digital exclusives. Thanks for watching.